Oh man, the lighting is shit. Why does my face look like that? Oh wait a minute, I forgot to play it. Okay, now I can. Oh, there's more light there. Oh, it's 9:39 a.m. I just did 5 minutes of voice. Sort of practice, but yeah. So I'm getting ready to go to the job agency. Hey, I was thinking of taking a break from YouTube and all of my social media activity for about, I don't know, since about a year and a half. That's my plan. And then today morning, I don't know, I think I'll just make videos for the time being, because I like to document my life and, So yeah, so I'll make my videos. So I'm gonna go over there. I'm gonna go to the job agency today. So I was thinking to myself, am I a transsexual? What does that mean to be a transsexual? And I don't know how to answer that question. I guess I am objectively a transsexual. I don't know what that means subjectively. So your subjective experience is unique to you. So objectively, I am a transsexual, because I have transitioned. I was thinking, the reason I was thinking about this was because when I decided in my mind not to make any videos, I felt like, oh shit, okay, now I don't have to. Now, it's sort of like I felt like I was free to actually sort of think, was transitioning a good thing for me, or is it like a, what do I feel about my transition like 3 years later? And I was thinking about that. Am I happier, or am I happy with my decision, or whatever? And also like my surgery, am I happy with that? I was thinking about those kinds of questions. Well, there are reasons why I'm thinking about that. I am happy with them. I am happy with my decision to transition and all of that. But you know, when you transition, it's like, and also the reason I was thinking about this was also because I'm listening to this audio book. It's called The Rational Male. They have a blog, and they're talking about what it means to be a man. I think it's a very, very good book. I think men should read it. If you're a man, I do believe the guy who writes it, he's a pretty smart guy. He's very thoughtful, and he's making me think. So about like how there's this view that we live in a very feminized culture, and that men are, they don't feel like they have a place in it. And so this guy is sort of trying to talk about this positive kind of masculinity, and you know, so he's very you know, his points are, you know, I find them interesting, and I think men should read it. It's not going to help me. It's not going to help me, but it will help. I do believe it is good for men to read that book. They might not agree with it, but I do think they can it can be thought provoking. So I've been listening to that book. So I guess this is one of another reason why I'm thinking about these questions. Am I happy with my transitioning? Why was I unhappy with being a guy, or, you know, being a man? Was it due to living in a feminized culture, or what was it about me that made me very unhappy with that masculine kind of role or way of being, or, you know? So that's what got me thinking. And no, I would still be unhappy if I was living like as a guy. I would still be unhappy, because for me, it's not really about the feminism or whatever. It's because most of the stuff in this book, you know, The Rational Male, I actually ordered the print version. He's got another one called The Rational Male Preventative Medicine. I got that one as well. Also got a book by Frida Kahlo, the you know, the Mexican artist. I saw like a video about her, and I found it interesting, so I got a book about her. For me, it's not really about because this book is about basically there's a way it's about teaching men to be who they are, but the most of the book is about there's actually a lot in that book. But one of the sections is like how men should relate to women, and anyway, so it seems to be like how can men get women, you know what I mean? There's a lot of stuff about that, and for me, I wasn't thinking about that necessarily. I didn't really hate my masculinity as much as I felt like I felt depressed, or I felt like, I don't know, I just like I felt like something was missing. I felt even now, looking back on it, but like when I was living as a guy, I would be unhappy. I was unhappy, and there was a reason why I was unhappy, and that was because a part of me, you know, a very significant part, felt like a girl, felt identified strongly with the feminine. And it's not about wearing clothes or acting womanly. It's not about anything like that. It's just more like, this is how I felt inside. I can say this, like when I was 14 or 13 years old, you know, I was living in the United Arab Emirates, and that is a very patriarchal country, you know, so I wasn't exposed to feminism or whatever. It wasn't a reaction to feminism. Even back then, I remember the first time I had this feeling, and like inside, this internal sense of, I felt like internally I saw myself as a girl, or I felt comfortable with this internal perception or sense that that was always there. Like, it's like how I saw myself, you know, I saw myself as a girl. So this was there, like even when I was younger, I used to like, you know, flip through, like my mom had this kind of magazine of all these women's clothes and stuff. So I used to flip through that. And I used to see all these women wearing all these clothes. Now you might think, okay, that's just a young kid looking at women, and it might be some sexual thing, whatever. And maybe some of that was there. But so there are all of these things where, for some reason, and even like later on, I used to see the fashion TV channel. I used to like see them for hours, women, you know, kind of running on the model. And I just loved the way they looked. So to me, I would be extremely unhappy being a guy, and I was. So for me, transitioning was a good thing. It made me more happy. It made me realize, like, you know, I wasn't gay. You know, I never identified with that. It wasn't about sex, you know, it was something about something else. Like, I couldn't put a name to it. So when I heard about this trans thing, like, oh, wait a minute, these people exist? So anyway, so I so, you know, so I, yeah, I'm happy with my transition and with the surgery. Yeah, you know, I think that was a good thing because, you know, I don't, it helps with wearing clothes, and I, my hormones are much more effective, and, you know, yeah, so I wasn't really very, you know, sexual before I transitioned, and I wasn't really into all of that, so I never really thought about my sexuality when I decided to have the surgery. I wasn't really thinking about that. I was more, and you know, I don't like having, you know, too much testosterone. Yeah, so I was thinking to myself, you know, about that surgery, you know, like, you know, I've been thinking a lot about my sexuality lately, and, you know, that part of me represents masculinity. It's a symbol of masculinity. It's very strong. You know, and then my sexuality now is it feels like it's more in tune with who I am. So, but I would have given it more thought. I would have said, hey, wait a minute. I was thinking to myself, I probably would have given it thought, but I would still go with the surgery. But I probably would have given it a bit more. Like, I would have thought, oh, wait a minute, is this really what I want to do? Is really what I want to do? Because am I going to get the other surgery? Another reason I wanted to do it is because I didn't want to reverse back. Because if right now there's no way like my body can change back, you know. So I wanted that security of knowing that my body won't change back, because that was more frightening to me. The main reason I wanted to have that surgery done was I do not want my body to go back to the way it was. So I wasn't thinking about sexuality or anything about that. My main imperative, because I just didn't want to go back. That's why I had the surgery. And you know, it helps with wearing clothes, and you know. So, you know, yeah, I'm good with that. So, I guess it would be nice to have a stronger sexuality, but to me, the payoff of knowing that my body won't revert back, and that, you know, the other health benefit of not having to take such large amounts of hormones, to me, those two, and also the wearing clothes, and because it's very uncomfortable down there. Now it's not uncomfortable. So those benefits, those positives outweigh the, because my libido is, I mean, before I had the surgery, it was kind of low, but now it's like, you know, it's pretty much low. So the negative, objectively, the negative of getting something like that is that your libido is going to be low. But for me, the benefit of knowing that my body won't change, you know, and the health benefit of not having to take large amounts of hormones, and then given the fact that I'm not really that interested in being sexual, at least I wasn't before, but I've been thinking more about my sexuality now. The positives of the surgery outweigh the negative, which is the low libido. And also, like, my sexuality is very different now. It's not like it's not like I can say yes, everything is positive. There is a negative. The negative is a low libido, but for me personally, the positives outweighed the negative, the libido thing. So yeah, I mean, and also if I want to, I can take testosterone like supplements. If I want to have a higher sex drive, I can change that, but I don't feel like I want to. I don't feel like I need to. I'm quite comfortable with where my hormone levels are at the moment. So it's not like it cannot be messed around with. But for me, yes. But I guess what I want to say is, like, when I went to have the surgery, I wasn't really thinking about, you know, my sexuality and things like that. I really wanted to get the surgery for these other reasons. And now I guess, you know, I was thinking about that, you know, how does the impact of your, how does your surgery impact your sexuality? Like I said, to me, the positives, outweigh the negative. And it's not a major negative. It's just like, you know, whatever, you know, it's not a big thing. It's not like a huge part of my life. It never was. And, you know, in the future, you know, if I, you know, have to meet someone or whatever, and if this becomes like an issue, I can definitely go to my endocrinologist and ask for some ways to deal with that. So it's not like this is a permanent problem. This issue of libido can be medically addressed. So even that thing, so it's not like a permanent problem, you know, the libido can be changed. So it's overall, it is kind of a positive. You know, I don't have to worry about my body changing. I have lower, I only take smaller amounts of hormones. You know, I can wear clothes that are more comfortable. And if I need to change my libido, I can do that. So overall, I think, when I'm thinking about it that way, it was a good decision. But when I was, I guess what I'm saying is, when I initially went to do the surgery, I wasn't thinking about things like this. And now I had an opportunity to think about them, and, you know, I think, you know, it's a good decision. So yeah, I'm happy with my transition. I'm happy where I am. But, you know, listening to this book by this guy, The Rational Male, it really, you know, it made me think about these questions a little bit more, like, you know, what, why did I transition? So it was a good, so I transitioned because I was unhappy with some, you know, because a part of me felt wasn't being expressed or wasn't being manifested, which I felt was very, very important. It wasn't like a minor part. I felt like this part of me, this feminine thing, is a pretty major part. I do have some masculine traits to me, and I believe those are due to, you know, social conditioning mostly. And I grew up, you know, for almost 35 years with the testosterone in my system, and that would have had some impact on my brain development. So But you know, so I do have certain kinds of masculine things to me, but you know, the transitioning allowed me to be who I felt I was, which is you know, it's a girl, you know, I felt like a female, girl, woman, whatever you want to call, and I am, you know, that was a very important part inside of me that had, and it really doesn't have too much to do with feminism or anything, because I felt it as even, you know, in the United Arab Emirates, so it was something always in there, and finally when I put a label on it, it's like, oh, so that is what it is. So yeah, so I'm happy with my transition, but yeah, you know, it's good to be critical and self-introspective, you know, not be afraid to think about, you know, think about your decisions and, you know, do some introspection and you know, question them, and, you know, it can be scary sometimes. You get like, oh, did I make the wrong choice? No, but sometimes, you know, you just have to look at it and, you know, so yeah, so I'm happy with my transition. I'm, yeah. So, and I did it because inside I felt like I've had a strong feeling, like this is who I was. I felt like a girl, and I still feel like a girl. So, yeah. But, you know, you're dealing with a society that's so, like, against you. So, like, you really have society who's going to tell you, no, there isn't, this is, so you are facing huge obstacles. So, you know, if society was like, oh, we don't care, you know, do whatever you want, I wouldn't be thinking, I wouldn't be questioning myself. I would just be like, okay, this is who I am. And there are a lot of strong social pressures anyway, so yeah, I'm just wearing this, like, this is a normal skirt thing. This is that weird skirt with the bloody crappy whatever thing. So, it's 10 o'clock. I gotta go. I gotta go. Yes, I will make videos when I feel like it. And yes, I will make videos. And upload them when I feel like it. Yes. I have been buying lots of audiobooks. Like, oh man, I love it. Let me off this light. Yeah, I didn't notice my breasts have been developing a little bit better. I noticed the other day, oh, wait a minute, I've got side boobs. So it's coming like a shape. Before I couldn't see that. Oh, yeah, I do have. So, yes, I do have side boobs or something. And yeah, that they seem to be developing. Okay. Yeah, see, this way it looks like the French here. So messy. So messy. So, yeah, I'm gonna go now. Yeah. Oh, actually. My weight today was 64.7. I don't like this. When you bring it closer, it just so looks so, your face looks so. Oh my god. I need to. It was that weight. Well, 64.7 is it's a good place. It's better than 66. So I've been like consistently in the 64. So it's about being consistent. Gradually, hopefully, go down to 63, and then, you know, 62. You know, like that. Finished the appointment. It's okay. I gotta call my mother. It's a cloudy, rainy day. I'm gonna go home and relax a bit. depressing. Being unemployed. Being unemployed is quite depressing. Maybe I can do something about that. Maybe I can. So it's 11:55 a.m. I'm back. I ordered this movie, Wuthering Heights. It's directed by Andrea Arnold. I ordered the Blu-ray copy and they gave me the DVD. I am not happy with this. So anyway, I thought, oh, you know, I can't believe this. I wanted to, even the receipt says Blu-ray. Someone just put a, what did it? So that's like, what, $3 more for the Blu-ray? And that's so frustrating. I ordered a Blu-ray. I didn't order the freaking, this thing, I gotta always look like. That's better actually. So yeah, it was very depressing going to the job center. It's like, because they have this work for the dole program where you have to like work in order to get unemployment benefits. So that means you gotta like go to, I think I'll probably choose working for the Salvation Army or something. I feel so depressed. It's like, oh, fuck. I should be able to get a job, man. I've got qualifications. That's just so depressing. I can't even get like foot in the door. So I feel very, very depressed by my inability to find employment. So it's kind of depressing me. I feel depressed. Why the fuck is everything so slow? I don't know, everything was slow for some reason. Just somewhere, it's already in the movie, and it's just